I really enjoy electric brewing. It allows me to brew pretty much in any climate, hot, cold, whatever. But one of the downsides of electric brewing indoors is that you have to deal with the steam coming off of the kettle. Now, you can do what I have done and either build or buy a hood, which may possibly cost you hundreds or even thousands of dollars. There is another option, and that is the steam condenser. In this video, I'm going to show you how to build one that's not too expensive. There are a couple things that I want to get out of the way right up front. Number one is that these devices, when attached to a kettle, whether all-in-one or a different type of brewing system, they get extremely hot. So definitely use caution. Use a oven glove or a rag or something like that whenever you're handling these. Secondly, if you're looking at a steam condenser option to reduce any kind of smell, maybe your significant other doesn't like the smell associated with brewing, this is really not going to be a solution for that issue. It will help with the steam, obviously, but whenever you're boiling and it boils off DMS, it does have a weird smell. To me, it's less pleasant than the smell of actual brewing. And finally, you guys have to help me and hit the like button. The last time that my buddy Keith Stone asked you guys to hit the like button, we got more likes on that video than I've ever seen before. So unless you guys want me to have him come back and beg you for likes again, hit that like button. One other thing I wanted to cover is give credit for the designer of this. I am not the person that actually came up with this design. If you go over to Homebrewtalk, and I'll leave a link in the description down below for the thread over there, Brewing Dog on the Homebrewtalk thread actually developed this, came up with the parts list, everything except for what I'm using to adapt it to the all-in-one systems. And that's another thing. It's not just for all-in-one systems. If you use the T and the spray assembly, you could port that into the side of a kettle and use it on a regular system as well that just has a lid that sits on top. But this will work with the way I'm showing it here, will work with the Brewzilla, the Easy Boil, the Grainfather, the Anvil Foundry. I mean, pretty much any of the all-in-one systems that have the ability to have a metal lid on them with a hole in them. So what you're going to need to construct this is a 1.5-inch triclamp 90, a 6-inch triclamp spool, a 6-inch T. And then for the sprayer assembly, what we've got is a 1.5-inch triclamp to 1/2-inch NPT, and that's a completely through, so it will accept 1/2-inch NPT on the top and the bottom. Then you're also going to need a 1/2-inch NPT nipple that is 2.5 inches long, a 1/2-inch NPT to 1/8-inch NPT adapter, like a bell adapter. And then you'll also need the 1/8-inch NPT spray nozzle, and that is a 9.49 gallon per hour at 40 PSI spray nozzle. I believe that the spray pattern on it is 30 degrees. Now, before you go clicking off the video going, oh my God, it's another one of those things that uses a whole bunch of water and I don't want to use something that uses 10 gallons of water while I'm brewing, blah, blah, blah. There are a couple things to consider. Number one, reduce your brew, your boil time to 30 minutes, and that will help. But then secondly, later on in the video, I actually have a recirculation option that I'm going to go over with you that uses about 4 to 5 gallons of water for an entire hour boil. One other thing to note, whenever you construct the spray components, everything needs to have a good amount of Teflon tape. You're talking about 40 to 60, even 80 PSI sometimes. So you wanna make sure that everything is nice and Teflon taped when you put it together so you don't have any leaks or anything like that. Now you're also gonna need a 3/4-inch hose bib if you're gonna hook this up to like a faucet or your hose fitting outside, along with some reinforced high pressure tubing. And then also some 3/8 hose clamps. Now the connections to the sprayer are a 1/2-inch MPT 90 to 3/8 hose barb. And then on the bottom of the T assembly where the exhaust or the exit for the fluid is, the steam and both the spray from the condenser, that is a 3/4-inch to 1.5-inch tri-clamp barb. And then I have spec'd in the parts list to get 2 feet of hose. I have a little bit less than that and it works fine, but you know, you might want a little bit longer hose so you can go down into a bucket. That is the other thing that I need to mention. When you use this device, you definitely cannot have the outlet end that is down in the bucket submerged in water. If you do that, it completely nullifies the suction and the vacuum effect that the venturi and the T has on the steam coming out, and it basically will stop working. Now you're also going to need 5 triclamps and 5 triclamp gaskets in order to put the entire assembly together. Now one thing I want to show you with regard to the way that the spray nozzle is positioned in the T, which I think makes this very effective, when you assemble everything, the spray nozzle actually sits below the opening in the side of the tee. So an issue with some condensers that I've heard of or seen out there is that they are actually, the spray is actually going back into the kettle. With this system, there's basically zero possibility of that happening because all of the spray that comes out of the nozzle is below that opening in the tee, which I think makes it highly effective. Now for the connection to the kettle, you're gonna need a bulkhead. And I actually found a specific bulkhead. I kind of bought this on accident for something else, but then when I started putting this together, it worked really, really well. It is an 1.5-inch triclamp bulkhead. And something that's different about this one than the other ones that I've seen, this one uses like a really thick silicone O-ring, which is like the same size as the entire diameter of the bulkhead. And what that allows is it allows it to give you a little bit of slack or a little bit of forgiveness, if you will, to attach it to the top of the lid. And when you attach it, just make sure that everything is centered and the nut is tightened down as much as possible. There's two sides to the nut on this thing, and make sure you use the one that's flat. If you use the side that has the ridge on it, it won't tighten down all the way. You may also be thinking, hey, this looks like it might be good for the bucket fermenter. Yes, it does actually fit the bucket fermenter lid perfectly. So if you're looking for an option for the Anvil bucket fermenter, this bulkhead actually fits that opening like a glove. Now, one of the things that I experienced after I got the assembly put together and got it installed in place, I did notice that the lid on the Anvil Foundry was just a little bit flexible and kind of flimsy. And I had some issues where it was kind of wobbling around, and I just didn't feel really great about that. So what I did was I actually employed there's a couple options you can do. The easiest and cheapest option is a 1/2-inch nut. Now that's like a 1/2-inch thread size nut. And then what I did was I basically just slid it right up underneath of the triclamp nut on the triclamp. And that actually provides enough support and keeps it from being as flimsy as it was without it. It does still allow, with everything attached to hoses and all that stuff, there is a little bit of a downward angle, which you do need on these steam condensers, so that if there's any water that accumulates in the pipe, the six inch tube, it will run downhill and out of the steam condenser. Now, the other option that you can do, which I also show here, I wanted to explore two different ones. If you have a couple tools, you can do this. I got a repair strap, which is like 1/2 inch and 2.5 inches long. And you can drill out one of the holes. The thread size, incidentally, on a triclamp is 5/16. So you would need to drill it with a 5/16 drill bit and then put a bend accordingly to however, you know, whatever you want as far as how much you want to support it. And I did mine. You can see how I did mine. And I used a 5/16 nut, stainless steel, to also secure it in the triclamp. So all I have to do is put the triclamp on and then flip this brace down. And it works just about as well as the nut. I think the nut is a little bit more secure. But one of the things you might be pondering about the nut is, okay, great, I'm gonna take this thing and take the lid off of the anvil or whatever I'm using, and the nut's gonna go flying across the floor and I'll never find it again. So a solution for that, if you want to, is just put a zip tie on the nut and zip tie it to the actual tri-clamp itself, and that'll keep it right in range where you need it at, and then you can just slide it underneath the tri-clamp whenever you need to. All right, I have to break into the video here. Literally, as I am editing the video, I get an email from Anvil, and they actually have developed or made a bulkhead that is specifically designed for the Foundry. And I got it just as I was editing this. So here's an image of it, and I'll leave a link for that down below, which probably will nullify the whole bracket thing. But just wanted to throw that out there. It happened just as I was editing the video, as usual. All right, back to the video. Now let's talk about how it performed. I did some testing before I got the 6-inch tube and used a sight glass that I had. And the cool thing about the sight glass is it kind of allowed me to see what was going on inside. So as the temperature rose, I was using the Anvil Foundry doing the testing on 240 volts. As the temperature rose up, I started to see steam accumulating in the sight glass. And then as the temperature got higher and higher, it started to accumulate more and more. And I had it was tilted pretty good. And you could see that the steam was starting to condense in there. And this is before I ever even turned on the sprayer. And as it got up near boiling, you would actually see some steam and vapor starting to come out of the bottom of the hose, which indicates that, you know, the thing is working as it should be. And then as soon as I kicked on the sprayer, then everything started to pull through there. And I mean, you could kind of see the droplets moving through the sight glass, which is interesting because you really can't see inside of the stainless tube. So that was really interesting for me to see that as well. Now, in my test that I did an hour boil. And I used the Anvil Foundry on 70% on 240 volts, and I boiled off 3/4 gallon. So normally boil off is about a gallon, but I boiled off 3/4 gallon using the steam condenser. You could probably turn the percentage of power down a little bit more and still, you know, and boil off plenty. But I used 9 gallons of water whenever I did that, which is not too horrible. But, you know, there is some consumption of water if you don't use the recirculation method that we're going to talk about here in just a second. Now, on 120 volts, I used 80% power, and I actually boiled for 30 minutes just to give me kind of an idea of what I was looking at. And the amount that I boiled off at that time was a pint. So basically, you could look at, if you're boiling for an hour, you're going to get a quart of boil off, which is about, you know, that's a little bit, that's almost half of what you get if you boil with the lid off. Now, speaking of boil with the lid on or off, I definitely recommend not putting the lid on or the steam condenser with the lid and everything on until you reach a boil and you deal with your hot break. If you don't, there's a good chance that the hot break can get up all the way to the top and then come out of the steam condenser, and it just makes a horrendous mess. So my recommendation is definitely not to take it all the way to boil with the lid on, bring it to boil, deal with the hot break, then continue with your steam condenser operation. Now, the recirculation option was pretty interesting. I found a pump that's like $20, draws 3 amps. I found a power supply that was actually 3 amps. I also found that the power supply that I have spec'd has an adapter, so you can actually wire in the raw wires from the pump into this connector, and then you just connect and disconnect it as you need it. And that pump is capable of putting out 80 PSI. It does have an adjustment on the end. You can screw and unscrew the set screw in the end of the pump head and adjust what the pressure is, turning it on and off. The only downside really to the recirculation pump is that it is a little bit noisy and can be a little bit annoying. It's not overly noisy. It's about 61 decibels or something like that at a couple of feet. And, you know, me talking right now to the camera like this, this is probably anywhere from 70 to 75 decibels. So it's not as loud as me talking in a room. But I will tell you that I was editing a video while I was doing the testing, and the, you know, it would build pressure and then stop, build pressure and stop, and it would kind of be like brr, brr, brr. So that did get a little bit annoying. So just be aware that, you know, if you do use the recirculation option, it can be a little bit annoying to people in the room or whatever, but it is a way to definitely save on water. So what I did with the test of the recirculation pump was I had 4 gallons of water and let it run for an hour. And what I did was about halfway through, I put probably about 3 or 4 pounds of ice. It was like basically the ice tray from my fridge down here in the basement. I dumped it in the bucket, and I started out with like 60 degree water, dumped the ice in halfway through. And then by the time I was done with the boil, it was only about 110 degrees, something like that, in the bucket. So that's definitely enough of a temperature differential between what's coming out of the kettle and what's going into the steam condenser to be able to condense the liquid and have a good use. One quick wiring note on the pump, if you decide to go that way, on the adapter that comes with the power supply, it has a positive and a negative. The red wire goes to the positive terminal and the yellow wire goes to the negative terminal. The other thing that I found with the pump is that you need to prime it before you hook it up to the steam condenser. So it is a self-priming pump, but because of the resistance of the nozzle in the steam condenser, it won't pull the liquid out as easily as if you just disconnect the hose, prime it, let it start flowing through, and then hook it up to the steam condenser. So that's just kind of a little caveat of using that. I know this was a long video. I really appreciate you staying to the end if you made it this far. You know, if you enjoy this type of video, give it a like. Let me know in the comments down below that you enjoyed the video and this is something that you're interested in. This has been Brian for Short Circuit of Brewers. We'll see you on the next video.